Okay, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I would like to thank Peter Berger for his invitation. It's very flattering for me to be here, and I would like to thank him for having me here, and I look forward to the discussion. My talk is divided into different parts, and I will rely on some empirical data. This means I don't want to continue only the theoretical considerations and debate, but also to stick to some empirical foundations and some empirical analysis. In my talk, I would like to raise only one question. What are the consequences of the pluralization of the religious field on individual religiosity? Peter L. Berger assumes that religious diversity undermines the taken for granted certainty of religious belief systems, and he assumes that religious homogeneity will enhance the validity of religious belief systems. Even if he distanced himself from the secularization theory, he didn't give up this, that assumption. His recantation of the secularization theory had only empirical reasons. In the light of the explosion of impassionate religious movement in modern and modernizing societies such as the US or countries in Latin America or in Asia, he gave up the secularization theory, but he still holds on at the assumption that religious heterogeneity will have corrosive effects on the stability of religion, of religious convictions and practices. And he makes the point that in the case of religious pluralism, the different religious faiths will undermine each other, they will question each other, and they cannot be longer taken for granted, so that the stability of religious orientations, identities, practices, convictions will be weakened. And I think in the meantime, some alternative approaches came up. For example, the so-called economic market model. And the economic market model reverses his assumption, namely that to the extent that different religious orientations are available, the overall level of religiosity will rise instead of decline. This means that the different religious orientations challenge each other to improve their performances, their religious services, so that the providers of religious goods are provoked to provide a better service for the religious consumers. I don't think that it is an exaggeration that the proponents of the economic market model developed their thesis in a direct dissociation from Berger's approach. They reversed his assumption that religious diversity erodes the stability of religious orientations, and they traced back their approach to the fact that in the case of having different religious orientations, not only the providers of the religious goods are challenged, but also the individual has more individual choices. The religious individual can choose between different religious options and select that option which fits more his or her religious desires and needs. So that in the case of a religious monopoly, for example, the religious individuals, if they are satisfied with the religious offers, will give up their religious orientation altogether, so that the pluralistic situation gives the individual more chances to find the proper religious orientation for him or herself. I think both approaches are convincing on a theoretical level. Something speaks in favor of the first one, something speaks in favor of the second one, and on the theoretical level, there is no way to decide which is superior. And that's why I will not continue the discussion on the theoretical level, but switch over to the level of empirical analysis. And by doing so, I want to compare the religious situation or the situation of religious pluralism in the United States with that in Western Germany. And I will subdivide my leading question into two. The first question is, to what extent has the degree of religious pluralism really increased in the United States and in Western Germany? And how much does the religious situation, the degree of religious pluralism in the United States and in Western Germany differ? And my second question is, how does religious plurality influence individual religiosity? In 1949, when the Federal Republic of Germany was founded, 96% of the West Germans belonged to one of the large Christian churches, either to the Catholic Church or some of the Protestant churches. This means only 4%. 4% in 1949 were either unaffiliated to any church or members of the congregational chapels or members of non-Christian religions, only 4%. In the meantime, today, only 70% still belong to Christian churches in Western Germany, either to the Catholic Church or Protestant churches. About 20% are unaffiliated, and 10% are members of congregational chapels or the Russian Orthodox Church, Buddhism, Hinduism, Judaism, Islam, or some esoteric groups. You can see it, the numbers on the table. For example, alone 5% belong to Islam in Western Germany. In the US, the degree of religious pluralism also has increased. In the 19th century, Protestantism entirely dominated the religious landscape. Even in 1960, about 70% of the population belonged to Protestantism. In the meantime, only 50% are Protestants. 50% of the Americans are Protestants, 25% Catholics, less than 2% are Jewish, and between 2 and 3% Buddhists, Hinduists, Muslims, and so on. This comparatively small percentage of people who belong to a non Christian religious tradition comes as a surprise, I think. Since we associate the United States with a country full of religious pluralism, religious diversity, competition, and religious dynamism, and maybe the figures are apt to question our image. Religious pluralism in the U.S. is predominantly a phenomenon of Protestantism, within Protestantism, but not so much between different religious traditions. Denominational distribution in the U.S. and in Western Germany is rather similar. Look at the figures again. 3/4 are members of a Christian church. 1/5 are unaffiliated, and no more than between 5% and 8% belong to a non-Christian religious community. And if you look at the pluralism index, the pluralism index in the US, if you count Protestantism as one religious group, is even smaller than in several European countries. If you subdivide Protestantism into several groups, Lutherans, Congregationalists, Presbyterians, and so on, then you get a higher score at the pluralism index. This means that the degree of pluralism in US is higher only if we take into account the different Protestant groups in the US. But if we take Protestantism as one religious group, then the pluralism index is smaller compared to some Western European countries, Western Germany or Great Britain as two examples. This is on the level on states and countries, but people do not make their religious choices on the macro-sociological level. They make their choices on the individual level, on the level of family, on personal relationships, what ties they have to the neighborhood, and so on. And that's why I'm going now to analyze the degree of religious diversity on that level, on the individual level. And I look for the religious diversity of marriages, of the family, of neighborhoods, and contacts at work. By looking at the intermarriage patterns in West Germany and in the US, we observe that in the United States, only a minority is married with of the Christians. Only a minority of the Christians is married with non-Christian religious people. For example, look at the second line, the U.S. 78 of the married Catholics are married with Catholics, and another 14% of the Catholics are married with Protestants, and only 3% are married with people who are members of a non-Christian religious tradition, and 5% are married, of the Catholics are married with people who are unaffiliated to any church. This means about 90% of the Christians are married with other Christians. And the same is true for the Protestants. 90% of the Protestants in the US are married with other Christians, and only a minority is married with people from other religious traditions. And the same applies to Western Germany. Also, a majority is married within their own religious tradition, and only a minority, a very small minority, exceeds the boundaries of their religious tradition. This means that Christian majority reproduces itself and keeps the doors to the outside relatively closed. And this is true for the United States and for Western Germany as well. The intermarriage homogeneity among the unaffiliated is lower. If you look at the last two lines, you can see the unaffiliated people are married with other unaffiliated people only to 60% in Western Germany and 40% in the US. And the lower degree of religious homogeneity of the unaffiliated in the US might be due to the fact that the US has a higher degree of overall religiosity and more people define themselves as being religious. But what about the religious pluralism in the wider family, in the neighborhood, at work, and in the spare time? The Bertelsmann Foundation carried out a survey in 2012, and they asked people in various European countries and in the US how many people in their family to which they have regular contact belong to a different religious group than themselves. And the answer is here. Look at the last line. Only 17% of the Americans say that more than half of the people in their family to which they have regular contact belong to a different religious group than themselves. Two-thirds say that less than half of the people in the family to which they have regular contact belong to a different religious group than themselves. In Europe, the share of people who have regular contacts to people of a different religious tradition within their family is a little bit lower, but the difference is not high. The countries are to a certain extent comparable. The same pattern applies to the religious diversity of regular contacts people have to other people in their neighborhood, at their workplace or place of training, and in their spare time. Look at the different tables, family, neighborhood, all the patterns are very similar. In any case, only a minority states having most of their regular contacts to people who belong to a different faith than themselves. To sum up this point, in order to deal with my first question, religious diversity has been growing in the last decades, both in the US and in Western Germany. The degree of religious pluralism seems to be higher in the US than in Western Germany, but the difference seems to be rather minor. Let me come to my second question, which is more profound. What are the consequences of religious pluralism for individual religiosity? I measure religious individual religiosity by church attendance, by belief in God, by religiosity defined by the people themselves, and the importance people place to spirituality. It's a rather broad definition of religiosity, but it could be broader if we would take into account some other indicators. But I will do it. I think it will do for our purposes. Okay, what can we see if we correlate interreligious contacts with religiosity? And taking it by and large, we can say that in the US, regular contacts to people with other religions with different religious orientations do not have the effect of increasing church attendance or belief in God or religiosity or spirituality. On the contrary, as far as the majority of people to which Americans in their family, in their neighborhood, at their workplace, or in their spare time have regular contact, belong to different religious groups, they tend to attend less often Sunday services than those Americans whose contact persons in their majority do not belong to a different religious group. In the US, contacts to people of a different faith do not contribute to an increase of church attendance, but have the reverse effect. In Europe, there is no significant correlation. If you look at the table, N, S stands for no, not significant. There is no correlation between interreligious contacts and church attendance in Europe, but there is a negative one in the United States. This means that the probability that people believe in God or attend religious services in the US is lower if they have interreligious contacts. In Europe, however, belief in God and religiosity are not inhibited by interreligious contacts. In some European countries, look at the table, such as Sweden, Switzerland, and France, belief in God, religiosity, and spirituality even profit from interreligious contacts. The correlations are reversed to what the so-called economic market model assumes. In the US, religious homogeneity tends to reinforce religious vitality. In highly secularized European countries such as Sweden, Switzerland, and France, belief in God and spirituality are enhanced by a religiously diverse context. The explanation for this counterintuitive results could be that in the religious vital United States, people feel more challenged by people who have a different religious belief than in Europe, and that in Europe, people feel more provoked by people who are not religious at all, who don't belong to a different religious tradition, but who are not members of a church, or who don't believe in God, or who define themselves as not being religious. In the US, one's own belief is especially questioned by other beliefs. In Europe, especially by non-believers. This means that the dividing line in the US goes between different religious orientations, and the dividing line in Europe goes between religion and non-religion. In both cases, religious practices and convictions are supported by people who share the same practices and convictions. In one case, the people of a different faith who inhibit one's own religiousness are those who belong to a different religious group. In the other, they are the unbelievers. In other words, a religiously homogeneous surrounding, as differently its boundaries may be defined, does not weaken but strengthen religious vitality. I think Peter Berger's hypothesis that religious diversity undermines the plausibility of religious convictions and religious homogeneity enhances it is confirmed by this empirical analysis in a splendid way. The positive correlation between religious homogeneity and religious vitality is also underscored by another result of the Bertelsmann analysis. If people have most of their contacts with religious people, irrespective of their religious belonging, their church attendance, and personal religiosity will be higher compared to people who don't have this kind of contacts. This applies to Europe and the United States as well. In any case, being embedded in religious networks reinforces religious convictions and practices. If the economic market model sometimes comes to the reverse conclusion, namely that it detects positive effects of religious pluralism on the vitality of religion, maybe that has to do with the fact that a religiously plural surrounding fosters the internal ties of the religious communities. I would like to come to my conclusion. It can be regarded as certain that modernization leads to religious pluralization. As we have seen in our empirical analyses, religious pluralization has a more or less negative effect on the stability of church adherence and religiosity and spirituality. And this result can be confirmed by some other observations. For example, if you look at the United States, Protestantism is the most diverse religious community, and at the same time, Protestantism in the US is in a decline, more than any other religious community. In the 1960s, more than 70% belonged to Protestantism. Now it's about 50%. Or look at Europe, for example. Most of the European countries have become religiously more diverse in the present compared to the time 20, 30, 40 years ago. At the same time, they have become more secularized. And insofar, I think we can confirm the result of our analysis that religious pluralism has a negative effect on the capacity of religious community to integrate their members and to attract new members. On the contrary, religious diversity will undermine the stability of religious orientations. And if we put both arguments together, then we can not only see that modernization will lead to a higher degree of religious pluralism, but also that, that religious pluralism has a negative effect on religiosity. And this means that we can safely conclude that modernization will lead to secularization. That is what Peter Berger denies, but I think the conclusion is more or less convincing, and insofar I would suggest that Peter Berger recants his recantation of the secularization theory, and maybe there are some good reasons to come back to the to his earlier version of the secularization theory. With this suggestion, I would want to conclude. Thank you. Okay. Do we have a chairman? Okay, I'm the chairman. Okay, I moderate the session. Okay, please. No. I didn't do it. I didn't only for the US in comparison to some European countries, but the Bertelsmann Foundation has included at least 20 more countries. I could do it, but I haven't done it. Okay. Maybe the results will not be so clear as here that we have reverse effects of religious pluralism. But I wanted to show this clear patterns.
Do you think, another question is, pluralism is a very, very broad concept. And there are different kinds of pluralism. Mm. If you use another framework, which is majority minority
I think the minority-majority relationship refers to pluralism, but it's not the same. And I did some studies about the contrast between Eastern and Western Germany, and we have a situation of religious majority in the West and religious minority in the East. And the impact of the majority, be it a religious or a irreligious majority, is detectable. In Western Germany, for example, people tend to accept Christendom, Christianity, Christian values to a high degree. And in the East, the pressure which comes from the majority of the unaffiliated is also visible within the church. You don't have the effect you could expect according to the market model that in the situation of a religious minority, people feel more affiliated to the church in the East, since they are in the minority and they have to defend their faith in front of an irreligious majority. You have this more or less similar patterns within the churches, and in the East, the church ties are even weaker compared to the West. And only a very small minority of the church members are committed to their church in the East, and they feel as provoked by the majority. But the majority of the church members in the East, in East Germany, take over some criticism of religion or of the churches of the majority, and insofar the pressure of the majority can be detected within the church. Yeah, it would be interesting to take into account other countries, and I think it would be important also to include some other factors. For example, the degree of modernization, economic growth, or state relationship, historical traditions. I think the different factors also have a moderating effect on religiosity. Insofar, the model has to be more complex if we take into account different countries. To some extent, they are comparable, but in other respects, they are different. For example, if you look at the living conditions, if you assume that the living conditions also have an effect on religiosity, then maybe there are some intervening factors. Okay.
Deadlift, I'm sorry that you feel I should go back to where sometimes I refuse to retract my rejection of secularization theory. I refuse it when Steve Brooks suggested it somewhat 20 years ago. I'm sorry, you seem to retract our piece of Westphalia. Evangelicalism has very distinctive So that's one problem I have with the categories that are being used. To make other criticisms, but Protestantism is an important one. Mm.
Yeah. In one of my slides, I subdivided Protestantism into different groups, including evangelical Protestantism, Lutherans, Presbyterians, and Congregationalists, Episcopalians, and so on. And if I do so, then the index of pluralism in the US is much higher. But the difference is not so high that I would speak of a totally different situation. But maybe I should pay more attention to the internal differences within Protestantism, even if the differences seem not to be so huge. Yeah, I agree. In the Westphalia peace, the different parties came up with the solution to have a more or less neutral state in order to allow the different religious groups to live together peacefully. And secularism in this definition would mean that that people agree that they can't agree on certain points. For example, they agree that we don't know the eternal truth, and that's why we have to dispense with this question. And secularism is a kind of reaction on the religious wars in the 16th and 17th century in Europe. And this is different, I think, from religious pluralism insofar as this was one of the questions which were raised before, insofar as religious orientations have the tendency not to restrict themselves, but to make statements about the entire world. They define the world. Insofar, they tend to come in conflict with other worldviews. And I would think that there's a difference between the state and the legal regulation of religious pluralism and the way people live their different religious traditions in their everyday life. And if you take seriously the ambitions and the claims of the religious traditions, then it's not so easy to restrict religion only to its own sphere. What does it mean? Religion makes statements about sexuality, about family, about politics, about the legal foundations of our society. And so far, I think there's always a tendency that religious pluralism leads to conflict on the cultural level. But I would suggest that we could agree that the different religious traditions should acknowledge the rule of law. That, I think that will do. That will be enough. We should not expect the religious people to confess that they believe in the Western values. But if they stick, if they accept the rule of law, then maybe there's a way of living together.
Secularity, I think, is an inevitable result of modernization. Secularism is not. Mm-hmm. But secularism can also be defined in different ways. Mm-hmm. In the Soviet Union and any other traditional communist society, secularism meant an atheistic worldview that was officially established, that was tolerated. Basic philosophy was atheistic, secularism. Secularism means something very different in the United States and in India, for example. Secularism, I would say in much of the Western world, secularism as an ideology rather than as a worldview is the French model. Religion has no place in the public sphere. There are people who interpret the American Constitution, basically in a French way. Secularism, if people say they believe in the First Amendment of the American Constitution, they are not necessarily saying something secularist, unless they belong to the American Civil Liberties Union. Very interesting difference. In India, it means something totally different. It basically means we are not Pakistan. Challenged now by Hindu fundamentalists. We spoke about Hindutva and so forth. So secularism, in any case, there are different kinds of secularism, but I would sharply distinguish from secularity. Secularity is inevitable unless you want to stop going to the dentist. Okay? But secularism is inevitable.
One term is more an ideological term. The other one, a neutral term.
Secularity
is a descriptive term, neutral, value neutral.
Depending on pluralism, I have for a while only talked about plurality.
Mm-hmm.
And I was criticized, especially by a friend of mine, Anton Lederfeld, a sociologist, isms are just an ideology. And we're talking about secular this, secular that, say, the Netherlands, and we're talking about the fact. He's right. And secularism, as far as I know, the term was invented by Horace Kallen, a 1920s American philosopher of education, basically. But for a while I used secularity every time other people used secularism, I used pluralism. And then, I use plurality instead of pluralism. And people say, what do you mean by plurality? Sort of like pluralism? And I said, to hell with it. Let me say pluralism. Most people understand it as a fact.
Okay.
So, I don't know. Okay. You don't seem to disagree with that, so that's good.
Yeah, okay.
Years, the National
Judaism, conservative Judaism, I think, are really, by their own mission, in great trouble because of marriage, not of interest, et cetera, et cetera. What's growing is what's called modern Orthodoxy, where you've got some real attempt to live an ethical Jewish life within the conditions of modernity. So, you know, an Orthodoxy factor might be worth something.
But Judge, would you agree that in some ways the more progressive wing of the Catholic Church is more in common with liberal Protestants than an Orthodox evangelical has with a more Orthodox Roman Catholic? And you were part of that pool. Catholics and evangelicals together reflect that, it seems to be reality.
You know, this also has an interesting empirical cash out in terms of a very measurable thing, voting. It drives me crazy when people talk about Catholic vote. That phrase means absolutely nothing. Absolutely nothing. What counts is how often are you in church. If you're in church once a week or more, you're at one end of the spectrum. If you're in church once a year or less, you're at the other end. And then it just slides down the scale between them in a way that you could pretty much get the margin. So this question of practice, which is itself obviously a reflection of, you know, how committed are you to the world? How much is it at the center of the life? It seems to me to demonstrate the utility again on that very concrete basis.
Thank you for the suggestion. Maybe the effects of orthodoxy on the adherence to different religions or denominations go both ways. It's not only that orthodox denomination can thrive in a modernizing environment. There are also some counter effects. For example, many people, in maybe you know that in the US, the percentage or the share of people who say they have no religion has increased in the last 20 years dramatically, from 3% to almost 20% today. And what they say, if they are asked why they have defected from religion altogether, You see, if I look at the evangelicals and their mixture between religiosity and politics, this is not my way of thinking, and I'm not like them. That's why I give up the religious orientation, because of the mixture between the religiosity or religion and politics. Insofar, the orthodox orientation has also some counter effects. Maybe they can attract people. Maybe they are better in holding their people. For example, the liberal communities in the liberal Protestant communities in the U.S. Always lost many of their members. This was always the case, but they also attracted people. Now, the movement from the evangelicals to the liberal wing of Protestantism has declined. The evangelicals stay in their communities, since the evangelical communities have become respected communities. There is no need to change from one community to the other one. So I think it's a mixture of different motives we have to take into account. But I think it would be too simple to say all those who adapt to the modern world are in the decline, and the others are in the upswing. There's a move going both ways. And I would like to add one more point. If you look at the Catholics in Poland, in the younger generation, they attend churches, maybe to almost the same degree than the youth did 30 or 40 years ago. But at the same time, they don't comply to the moral teachings of the Catholic Church. And this means that we have to distinguish between different life spheres or value spheres. In some respects, people follow the Church. In some others, they don't follow. And the people make their choices. And it's always necessary to look at the individual level in order to come up with some convincing arguments, convincing explanations.
Yes, so pick and choose in the package, like Peter was saying, I'm Catholic, but.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly.
That's
Okay, please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you very much. As ever, they present figures and other questions are coming up. One question would be, is that correlation between religious pluralism and individual religiosity maybe directed to Christian backgrounds? Or is that the same for Muslims or for Buddhists, etc., concerning Europe and the United States? And the other question is, to just say in general that religious pluralism could lead to a weakening of individual religiosity. Do you have also results concerning those who have encounters with other religions and those who have not? Because you say you're only in the minority in Europe as well as in the United States, who have via family, work, leisure, etc., direct contact with other religions. Do you have any evidence that if there is any correlation between having those experiences with religious pluralism and the development of the own individual religiosity? And the last thing, I would assume that there is a big difference between minority and majority religions.
Okay. As to the first question, these are representative surveys, and as you can imagine, if in the U.S., for example, only 0.4% are Muslims, then in the representative survey, we cannot make any statements about the relationship of the Muslims to religion. This applies to people who are not affiliated to any church, and to Christians, Protestants, and Catholics. And we cannot make statements about the other religious groups. And in Germany, it's more or less the same. As to your second questions, I tried to do this what you wanted me to do. We asked the people whether they have contact to people of different religious traditions, and if they said yes, then we put them together with those who answered no and made a correlation. And this means that those people who stated that they have contacts in the majority of people with different religious traditions, it turned out that they don't have a higher degree of individual religiosity or church affiliation. This means we correlated contacts with individual religiosity. This was what I wanted to show. And as far as your third question is concerned, we had this already. I think you are totally right. It makes a difference whether a religious group is in the minority or in the majority, and maybe we should include this in our further analysis. Thank you.
You framed your presentation in terms of a conflict between the two pluralisms paradigm and the economic markets paradigm. But I wonder if those two things are not looking at different, asking different questions and looking at different kinds of phenomena. So there may be an apples and oranges problem with that comparison. The two pluralisms paradigm is about the coexistence of multiple religious viewpoints. The economic markets paradigm is about the coexistence of multiple religious providers. So the economic markets paradigm is not so much concerned with differences in the content of religion as differences in who provides the religious goods and services. So I'm thinking you might illustrate this by taking that place in Hawaii that we talked about before, where every possible religion is represented, all the different types of Christian religion and Catholics, and then there's Jewish and Hindu and Muslim and Buddhist, and they all come out and say aloha to one another, right? Set aside that, say, a typical medium-sized community in the rural American South, where you may have, say, 40 Baptist and non-denominational churches in town. And Baptist and non-denominational are fairly close to each other. And then maybe seven, ten Pentecostal churches, one Presbyterian church, one Roman Catholic church, and maybe a synagogue. Maybe. In that community, those, say, 40 to 50 Baptist and non-denominational churches will be competing fiercely with one another for congregants. They're in that's the economic markets model right there. They're competing. And if you ask them whether they're competing for congregants, they'll say they're not. But that's rampant hypocrisy. And I attend a Baptist church, so I'm allowed to say that. They're fooling themselves. They're totally competing for congregants. But if there are theological differences between those Baptist and non-denominational churches, they will be fairly muted. Maybe some of them will be Calvinistic, and maybe some of them will be anti-Calvinistic. But for the most part, the differences between those churches will not be very theologically freighted. So I wonder if it might not be the case. And then you think about rural American South is a very religious type of community. So it might well be that competition among religious providers increases religiosity, whereas competition between religious viewpoints or theologies might not. Now, that's a theory, and I don't have any data to present on it. Mm. But I want to present that as a question about the way you've interpreted your data.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder if I'm mistaken with the Buddha, young Catholics, as it gets older Catholics. And you mentioned sexual morality. I would say that sexual morality is very much sui generis, especially when you're talking about different age groups. And it's very difficult to revoke the general license. You can fornicate basically whenever you want to. And if someone wants to take it away from you, or if you thought it was taken away and you abused, there would be fierce resistance. It's much easier to give way on on orthodoxy in the sense of belief systems, roles of Virgin Mary, or the authority of the Pope, as long as he doesn't interfere with your bedroom. I think it's interesting to look at this that way. Well, I want to point out that it's 10 to 12.
Okay.
Well, I'm not chairman anymore, you are, but I want to point out, I mentioned before, a very leisurely conversation, and we've had it for the last 3 hours, more than we should have. It's not the Japanese railway timetable. First been from Marita to Tenzin, the next one 10:12, 10:13, 10:20. No, we had lots of time. But unfortunately, we've only mistaken planning. We only have 1 hour for lunch. But if you want to eat, I do. We better stop it.
But one question is left. Maybe I should answer the question as good as I can. Yeah? Okay. I think the proponents of the economic market model make the distinction you made between the institutional level, the level of the providers, and the level of individual religiosity. And how can competition be measured? That's the question. And they measure it by looking at individual religiosity. They look at church attendance, church membership, maybe belief in God. That are the indicators. And if the providers are successful, then the level of religiosity will increase. Insofar, it's totally right to distinguish between the level of the institutions, the providers, the communities, and there is a competition between the providers on the one side, but how can you measure the impact the competition has if you don't look at the individual level? And I think the market model has a wider scope. It's not only about competition between providers, religious providers, but it's also about the demand side. The religious needs are taken into account. And insofar, I'm not totally convinced that we so easily can differentiate between one and the other level, between the institutional level and the level of the individual. And at least as far as Rodney Stark, Lawrence Giannacconi, Roger Finke, and the others are concerned, they always combine both levels.